Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to the final week of the Spy Smithsonian series. We're happy to see all of you back here for one last time. It's unfortunate that we don't have an extra week. Could have very quickly thrown together a nice story about the assassination of Kim Jong-un's half-brother. Yeah, it's really cold when you kill your half-brother. I think it's even cold. If you've seen the pictures of the suspects, I think it's even colder when you send a woman with an LOL shirt to go do it. They're actually selling those now if you want to buy your very own assassin shirt. Well, yeah, it would be great if we sold them here, hint, hint, retail store. We unfortunately are finishing up for the spring. There'll be a wonderful one in the fall that we'll figure out what it's going to be. Oh, escape. Cool stories of escape. Amanda tells me it's going to be escape. That sounds fantastic. So be on the lookout for the announcement for that. But for today, we're going to end things in a great way with a good friend of ours, John Fox, who works about a block and a half that way at the FBI. We try to get, we've known John for a while, but we try to get formal biographies, the idea of, you know, we don't want to just make stuff up. But it wasn't until yesterday afternoon that we finally got John's biography. So at one point I was thinking I was going to have to make stuff up and say that John had just flown in from a one-man show in Vegas where he was working with Cirque du Soleil. But then you probably would expect show tunes and some kind of acrobatics, and that's probably not going to happen today. So the good thing is I do have John's official bio. Dr. John Fox Jr. has been the FBI historian since 2003. He was awarded a PhD in modern American history from the University of New Hampshire in 2001 and an MA in political science from Boston College in 1993. You look younger than that, but that's okay.
I was then.
You were then. His articles have appeared in the Journal of Strategic Security, the Journal of Government Information, the Law Enforcement Executive Forum Journal, the Journal of Cold War Studies, Studies in Intelligence, and others. He has contributed numerous pieces to the FBI's website and electronic FOIA reading room. Other publications include chapters in several books and The FBI, A Centennial History, which came out in 2008. He's been involved in several cooperative museum projects that you may have seen around town, including the temporary exhibit on the FBI and the media that was on display at the Newseum until this last summer. He's appeared on many documentaries in the US and Europe and on C-SPAN, CBS Sunday News, CNN, and somehow Turner Classic Movies, which I haven't done yet. That's one of the things I'm a little jealous of. So please join me in welcoming Dr. John Fox.
Back one. I thank you. I have been with the FBI now on my 18th year. I've been officially historian for most of that time and unofficially for almost all of it. So this is a subject that kind of hits close to home. I began my interest in the FBI back in grad school with an old spy case, a woman named Martha Dodd Stern, who was the daughter of our ambassador to Nazi Germany from 33 to 37, and she got recruited by the NKVD over there, came back, tried to be a spy, wasn't terribly good at it, but eventually got found out by the FBI. She fled to Mexico and then to Prague and found out that life in the East Bloc was not quite the bed of roses that she had thought it was as a younger woman, and eventually lived out her life in Czechoslovakia and died just after the fall of the Iron Curtain. So, Walter Krivitsky, on the other hand, passes her once or twice, at least people that they knew. I'm not going to necessarily get into that, but fitting with our theme here of assassinations, we're going to talk about a murder mystery, because the question of whether or not Walter Krivitsky was assassinated is an open one, and I'll certainly give my opinion at the very end, leave it to you to make up your own minds if you want to do some more research. But what I'd like to do is talk about a couple of different things, because I think the Krivitsky case is interesting for many reasons. One, of course, it talks about that milieu of the early Soviet agents, the people who got fascinated by the revolution, bought it wholeheartedly, moved into it, tried to foment revolutions around Europe and the rest of the world, and eventually ran afoul of the Stalinist machine in the 30s. It's also obviously a murder mystery, as I said. Was Walter Krivitsky killed? We'll consider that. It also tells us about the development of the Western intelligence communities. You know, we're going to start the story pretty early with the Soviet Revolution. And of course, intelligence was born and bred with that revolution for the Soviets. Tradecraft was practiced before and continued through. So by the time Walter Krivitsky comes to America in the late 30s, Soviets have been doing intelligence for two decades. What is the state of the American intelligence community? Well, it's pretty moribund. He goes over to England, as we'll see, and they're a bit better. They've been at it a little bit longer, certainly a little more avidly, and they're, of course, on the footstep of war, in fact, already at war. And so intelligence is very important for them. What are the differences that has to do with it? What do we learn from Krivitsky, who was an intelligence agent for so long for the Soviet Union? So I think those things will tell us a little bit about how our country was approaching the coming war, about how it was going to get into the Cold War and some of the impact it had there. Tells us something about the nature of our intelligence community. And so the story becomes much broader than simply this one person. So, with that, we begin with our murder mystery. Bellvue Hotel is on E Street, overlooks the Capitol on the front and Union Station on the back. A man named Walter Pareff checks in at 5 o'clock Sunday afternoon, 1941, February. So we have an anniversary that we just passed. Went to room 532, which was on the backside. So he was on the bad view because he got to oversee Union Station rather than the Capitol itself. But not too bad overall. Union Station's a nice looking building. The next morning, Pareff was found dead in bed. Shot through the temple. Gun was lying next to him, covered in blood. One hand was on his chest, the other hand was kind of splayed over to the side. And the maid quickly called for help. Doctor came, he was declared dead about an hour after the body was actually found, so almost immediately. Washington Metropolitan Police was there, took a look at it, said suicide, wrapped it up and turned the hotel room back to the hotel in about an hour. So 1 o'clock, the body's being shipped off to the morgue and the hotel room is being cleaned up. Well, the problem's this. Nobody knew who Mr. Pareff was. There was paperwork that suggested maybe his name was Ginsburg. And there was also paperwork naming a lawyer in New York named Lewis Waldman. He was a radical lawyer. Well, he wasn't that radical, but he took radical causes over the years. And when he was called, he immediately identified Ginsburg to himself. He wanted to know why they thought it was suicide. He said, no, this is the murder. Hung up with the Metropolitan Police, called the press, said Walter Krivitsky has been killed. Now, Krivitsky was well known in America. He had very publicly come out in 1939 through a series of articles about his role in Soviet intelligence. And Waldman said that, obviously, the NKVD has killed him. So he informs the widow, new widow, and heads right down to Washington, D.C. and begins pressing the Metropolitan Police to reopen the case, pressing the FBI to get involved, and so forth. So that's where we're at, a mystery. Who killed Walter Krivitsky? Well, before we start looking at some of the details on that, I would like to spend some time talking about who Walter Krivitsky actually was. You can see the initial representation in the press that actually made even bigger headlines over the next couple days. As you can see, many of them questioning whether or not Krivitsky himself he'd killed himself or whether it was a setup. So who was this guy? Well, it turns out Samuel Ginsberg was born in Poland, the turn of the 20th century, 1899. Herman and Augusta Ginsberg were Jewish by heritage, middle-class merchants. Very little is known about Krivitsky himself. In fact, Krivitsky is a name that he took on as his revolutionary pseudonym when he became a Bolshevik. The root of it is Slavic, meaning twisted or bent. And he kind of took that as his nom de guerre. So we really don't know a whole lot about his early life. In fact, a lot of it comes simply from what he told immigration authorities as he was moving around. Now, of course, by this time, he was a revolutionary. He was using fake names. He was using fake passports. He was blending in and out of different European countries in order to further the goals of the revolutionary movement. The area that he came from, in what was then Poland, pretty quickly subsumed under the Austrian-Hungarian Empire, eventually becomes part of what is now the Ukraine. So it is a crossroads of that Western-Eastern European mix. And it was the end of the train line before you go over into Russia. So it was a crossroads for merchants, for revolutionaries, for spies. And in fact, along with Samuel Ginsberg, a number of others came through. You can see where it's situated on the map. But among others that came out of there with him were Ignaz Paretsky, or Ignaz Reis, who was a very famous illegal Soviet agent in Europe in the 1930s, and a good friend of Krivitsky's. Misha and Brun Umansky. There were several Umansky in the Soviet intelligence operations. These two were not the most famous, but certainly were important in those early days. Willy Stahl, Alfred Krauss. So in a sense, the area itself was a hotbed for this revolutionary fervor. And of course, Krivitsky comes out of it saying, by the time he was 18 and the Bolshevik Revolution had come to him as an absolute solution to all problems of poverty, inequality, and injustice, I joined the Bolshevik Party with my whole soul. I seized the Marxist-Leninist faith as a weapon with which to assault the wrongs against which I had instinctively rebelled. He became a committed advocate of the Russian Revolution, despite having not been Russian by birth. Latched on to the Leninist, Marxist-Leninist wing of that party, the Bolsheviks, and very quickly moved into Soviet military intelligence. We think two major parts to Soviet intelligence that we know over the years. It's a very oversimplified picture of it, but you had Soviet military intelligence, and then you had what eventually becomes the KGB, which we all know much better. And it went through a whole number of names, OGPU, NKVD, so forth, to SVR today, and FSB, and so forth. So it's gone through a number of changes. But generally, the idea is the one is military intelligence, the other is foreign intelligence. For the most part, the agents that we think of having worked in the United States for Soviet intelligence came from the NKVD. We know much, or the KGB. We know much less about the GRU. And part of that has to do with some of what we'll talk about in the next few minutes, because in the 20s and 30s, the GRU in many ways was more active, more aggressive. And Ginsberg starts out with the GRU. And he's seconded to the Cominterner, the Communist International. This was the group set up by the Bolsheviks to foment revolution worldwide. They didn't just want to overthrow the Tsar and build a socialist government in Russia. They thought that this was the wave of the future and that the world itself should eventually be brought into the communist revolution. And it was activists like Ginsberg, Krivitsky, that were to do that. And so he goes around Western Europe working with the newborn communist parties or even the older strains of the communist parties as they come together. Eventually, each country getting its own dominant branch. You know, for instance, in the United States, 1919, we had the birth of a communist party, but we had two different branches, and it took many months, almost a year, for them to reconcile themselves, and part of that came with direction from Moscow. So Krivitsky's going around fomenting revolutions, supplying weapons, helping to bridge communication gaps between different parts of the groups. Oftentimes, he's failed miserably. In fact, in many ways, the promise of the Soviet Union didn't seem to be working out for some of these other areas. Remember now, the world we're talking about is the one right after World War I. Western Europe has been beaten up in many ways. Germany and France, two major powers, of course, now are recovering from the war. Germany itself, of course, is dealing with the repercussions of having lost. And the Weimar Republic is, although a liberal democratic government, an unstable one. The Soviet Union, on the other hand, has this glorious image that it's presenting. Best education. Revolution for the world. Of course, part of the reality was they too were dealing with the aftermath of this, both economically and politically. Famine struck the Soviet Union many times. You see from the some of the early magazines about it that it was a real problem. But what people saw was not the problems of life in the Soviet Union, but the promise of the revolution that the Bolsheviks were promising. And that image of a man-made heaven on earth was something that captivated people like Krivitsky. So, as I said, he went around fomenting revolutions in the 1920s. Sometimes the people that he was working with were wrapped up and killed, and he would sneak out. Other times, they basically started to set up the groundwork for a stronger Communist Party later. Of course, in Germany, that happened. And so at least by the 1930s, there was a small but active Communist Party there. And Hitler quickly wrapped that up when he took over. But Krivitsky himself continued to work in and through Soviet military intelligence through the 1930s. By the early 1930s, he was then moved over into the OGPU, or the KGB's predecessor. This happened a lot, because what happened was the two Soviet the Soviet intelligence apparatus would often struggle. You know, one would want to show up the other one. And different times, one was on the rise and the other was on the fall. In the 1930s, it was the OGPU, then the NKVD, which was on the rise. Of course, if you think about it, 1930s was in some ways a heyday for communism. Economically, the Western democratic capitalist system seemed to be falling apart. The Great Depression hit worldwide, and especially hard in America. People like Krivitsky, born middle class with some education, with an interest in affairs, with a sentiment towards justice, social justice. In America, those people in the 1930s started to move towards the communist side of the political spectrum. And we have the development of pockets of communist influence, even within the U.S. government. Think about the Department of Agriculture, and you had Alger Hiss and several other people who were working in there in the early years of the Great Depression. Think about Lawrence Duggan or some of the others, you know, names that become known as having worked with Soviet intelligence later on, becoming part of the New Deal government. So we have this fervor worldwide, again, for maybe that Stalinist vision, maybe that taking a backwards peasant Russia and catapulting it through a series of five-year economic plans into an industrial future where the workers rule is the way to go. And Krivitsky is working, again, through the Comintern to push that vision. Might be propaganda in one country, might be collecting intelligence in another, might be fomenting revolution in a third. By 1935, Krivitsky has been moving up in the intelligence apparatus and has become, in a sense, the head of intelligence in Western Europe. Now, it's not as big as it seems. It was somewhat scattershot. He operated out of, I believe, Holland and had responsibilities, obviously, moving south and east to some extent. South and west as well, because you get into Italy also. But Krivitsky became in charge of several crucial things. One, he was running undercover agents. You had, of course, in Germany, the Rockkapelle, or the Red Orchestra, that was growing. That was at least becoming an effective intelligence tool until it was quickly wrapped up. But the biggest problem, I think, for Soviet intelligence was actually internal to the Soviet Union, because by 1936, you start having a series of show trials and purges. Stalin he's consolidated power. Remember, Lenin died in the late 20s, Stalin takes over. Trotsky has to flees to France and then eventually Mexico. I'm sure Mr. Melton told you all about that last week, very graphically. All this has happened, and of course, Krivitsky's involved in the whole watching of Trotsky, you know, working with Mark Zbierowski, targeting Leon Sedov, you know, Trotsky's son in the 30s. So all this is interrelated. But in the Soviet Union itself, Stalin is now consolidated his power enough that he starts to target his enemies. And he goes after first the old military leaders and starts purging the Soviet military. And he turns then towards intelligence figures and to the Foreign Service. Eventually, anybody who had served in Germany, for instance, in the Soviet diplomatic establishment, with one exception, was executed for being a traitor. Now, this starts to worry people, especially old hands like Trotsky, like Krivitsky, because all of a sudden he's starting to see people he's known and worked with for years. Remember, Krivitsky came into the Russian Revolution on the ground level, right at the beginning. And so he's watching old friends and allies, people who were dyed-in-the-wool Bolsheviks, being accused of horrendous crimes, of treason, of sedition, of working with the Nazis, which ends up being ironic given the Nazi-Soviet pact isn't all that far down the road either. But all these people are coming out, and some of them very publicly announcing at these trials their guilt. And yet those who know them know that what they're saying is clearly wrong, clearly false. So obviously something very disturbing is going on behind the scenes. Now, for the true revolutionaries like Krivitsky, it begins with, well, okay, maybe there's something here and I just completely missed it. To maybe there's a deeper reason here, and yeah, we're, as Stalin had put it a few years before, in order to create a revolution, you need to break a few eggs. Maybe a few eggs are being broken, and that it was time for these people to go. To, I'd better start watching my back because I'm probably going to be next. And at the same time, he is being asked to help to run the Soviet support of the Republicans in the Spanish Civil War. Spanish Civil War breaks out in the mid-30s, arguably between the leftist Republican government and the fascist Franco government. The Soviet Union takes up the Republican side. Hitler provides some, at least, verbal support and a little bit more to the Franco side. And so it becomes a proxy war between Nazi Germany and the USSR. And it is Krivitsky's job to set up front companies throughout Europe to bring in money to support the Republican effort. Some of the money goes to the Republicans, some of it goes to Moscow. He helps to set up operations to buy weapons to send to the Republicans, reportedly not very good ones over time. And eventually, the Republican effort becomes imbued with or infiltrated with this whole purge mentality in the Soviet Union. And people who are considered too deviationist from the Bolshevik communist ideology are purged in the Republican movement. Remember now, there's a contingent, large contingent of American volunteers there called the Abraham Lincoln Brigade. They're kind of part and parcel of all this mix, eventually coming back here and focused on. There are others going through this as well, and Krivitsky is overseeing at least a fair part of it. But at the same time, he's also beginning to seriously suspect that something is wrong in Moscow. He goes back for a conference, for instance, and the new head of the OGPU starts to denounce the old head, who Krivitsky had known for and worked with for 10, 15 years. Denounces him as a seditious traitor. Krivitsky keeps his head down, keeps his mouth shut. He's eventually able to make it back to Western Europe, but the process is starting in his mind. Oh, by the way, in case you're wondering, I'm sorry, I should have explained this. This is a Picasso picture called Guernica, which was his representation of the Spanish Civil War. Obviously, there was a lot of violence. You've got your bull up there for Spanish culture and so forth, but I just thought it was an interesting representation of the conflict there. But the Soviet Union's role there kind of diminishes over time. They end up cutting off the Republicans after they con them out of their gold, basically. The Republicans, of course, were the government in charge when the war started. And the Spanish gold reserves were sent to Moscow to protect. They never came back. So Krivitsky is returning from Moscow. This is not long after that intelligence conference I was telling you about, where the new head was denouncing the old head. And remember, thousands of people are being purged. Families are being threatened, part of the reason why many of the old timers actually ended up saying that they had committed crimes, of which they really hadn't. Few people were sent to prison camps. Very few people actually ended up surviving those purges. But it all went to Stalin securing his power at the time. So Krivitsky is riding in the train back. And he says this is when he started to really question what he was doing. He was really starting to think about all those people he had known who had passed, been accused of crimes. And he knew that for himself, it wasn't going to be much longer. Then he gets an order from Moscow. He is supposed to betray Ignaz Paderewski. Ignaz Reis was another name he went by, who had been a very active agent, much like Krivitsky. In fact, they both came from the same place in Poland, born in the same community, grown up together, entered the revolution together. And Krivitsky was very torn because he knew, of course, Paderewski wasn't guilty. And yet he also didn't want to get himself condemned. He was still at heart a supporter of the Russian Revolution. And in many ways remains that through his life. He was very torn as to what to do. Obviously, he and Paretsky, you know, talked together. They compared notes. At one point, they were going to defect together. And Krivitsky put it off. Of course, eventually, Rees ends up murdered. And Krivitsky knows it's time. Krivitsky is ordered to return to Moscow just at the time that Rees is killed. So he starts to delay. He makes a connection in France and is able to at least stay there for a while. But at this point, he is a wanted man, certainly wanted from Moscow. At the time when he's in France, it appears that he talked quite deeply to French intelligence. Reports of some 80 volumes of information. Now, one, I doubt that very much. Two, of course, what happens to France within a year or so? It gets invaded. If there were any volumes about Krivitsky's communist operations, they would have been immediately shipped to Berlin to be analyzed. And they never did turn up in German intelligence files after the war, although there was an awful lot of purging in the final days of World War II. So there could well have been a lot of information from Krivitsky, but we can't know that. What we do know from what he has told other agencies, though, certainly wouldn't fill 80 volumes. So Krivitsky breaks from Moscow. He goes into open hiding to some extent, kind of watching his back. He knows who the figures are. He knows who the Soviets will send. Keeps his eyes open and begins looking to go to America because it'll be that much further away from the hand of the Soviet Union. And he eventually gets a tourist visa, comes over. And for the next 2 years, he will have serious immigration issues back and forth because of his status. No one's really sure who he is. He comes in claiming one thing and begins making connections with left-wing writers and so forth in New York, and eventually creates a series of articles that appear in the Saturday Evening Post. Those articles introduce him to America because he tells about the purges in the Soviet Union from a firsthand perspective. Because he starts to lay forth what he sees as some of the crimes of the Stalinist government. Now, Krivitsky obviously didn't have a great command of English. He certainly could speak it, but he was not comfortable in it, like he was in Russian or German. An American writer, journalist named Isaac Don Levine, who worked with Whitaker Chambers and others, worked with Krivitsky to put these together, as did a man named Paul Wall. But this is how America learned about him. In fact, this is how the FBI learned about him. We didn't know who Krivitsky was when he came in. Of course, he came in under a false name, among other things, but even then, we wouldn't have known who he was. When the articles came out, we went and interviewed him in the office of Lewis Waldman, the attorney I mentioned earlier who had gone down to DC the day that his body was found at the Bellvue Hotel. Krivitsky had become controversial. And what happens is this. The FBI interviews him and really doesn't learn anything more than what he had told in his articles. At some point in 1938, after the articles have come out, he is called to the State Department, in part to work over some of his immigration issues, because they wanted to deport him, because he had overstayed his visa at the time. To the State Department, he gives enough detail about a false passport operation that he had been knowledgeable of, that Earl Browder, who was a major American communist leader, and another person are eventually convicted for their roles in a false passport operation. But he still doesn't give much of the story of his career and role in Soviet intelligence at all. He keeps his mouth shut for the most part. Now, the Soviet Union starts to try to get back at him. I have this cartoon up here from The New Masses. It was done by a man named using the name A. Redfield. You may know him better as Sid Hoff. He did Danny the Dinosaur, if you've read that to your kids or grandkids or so forth. Sid Hoff was a noted children's book author, cartoonist, but in the 30s, he did cartoons for The Daily Worker and The New Masses. You'll notice the date, of course. The Nazi-Soviet Pact is there. He is trying to basically suggest that Krivitsky is working in cahoots with Martin Dies, the congressman who was running the House Committee on Un-American Activities. And Krivitsky had just testified along the lines of what he had written already. That's actually Al Capone. 1939 is the year that he got out of Alcatraz, having served 6 years for tax evasion. Actually, he was released on a health exception because he had terminal syphilis at the time and was starting to fall into dementia. But obviously, Mr. Hoff's take on Krivitsky suggests a combination of things, him being a clown and a fool. The New Masses article on Krivitsky was even more interesting because it described him as Shmuel Ginsburg, or Schmel. I'm sorry, my Yiddish is not terribly good, but it was a derivation of Samuel, which was, of course, his original name. You know, perhaps throwing an anti-Semitic aside in there by connecting him to a Jewish heritage there. It said that he was not actually a Soviet intelligence agent. He'd really spent most of his time over in France the previous couple of years being a drunk nightclub hopper, he may well have had a few drinks and hopped a few nightclubs, but he certainly was an intelligence agent. But they knew enough about his life and his origins to suggest that he was a fraud and that Americans didn't need to listen to him. I did find you a picture of Lewis Waldman, although it's from 1920, when he was defending some of the people who had been rounded up in the Palmer raids. Back in the day, it was a Bureau, FBI attempt to round up anarchists in the wake of a series of bombings the year before. It didn't go well, and it was certainly not been a good mark in our history, but Waldman over the years had taken on a number of causes like that, and so had been brought in to try and help Krivitsky out with some of his immigration issues and got to know him fairly well. I mentioned that Krivitsky was called before the House Un-American Activities Committee. Kind of interesting because it's the one committee in Congress where we know that there was at least one Soviet spy. Samuel Dickstein was a New York congressman. And for several years in the late 1930s, he was a paid Soviet agent. I'm not sure if the Soviets read Mark Twain, but his nickname was Crook. You may have heard the aphorism, the only native-born American criminal class is Congress. Dickstein certainly evidenced that. But what he did was he passed on information from the committee's files to the Soviet Union. And of course, the committee itself was looking into communist presence and influence in and around United States institutions. And so when Krivitsky comes in and talks about the false passport operation, talks about some of the other things that he had done in the articles, Dick Stein was supposed to push the information that he gave, both the public information and the private information, back to the Soviet Union, and he'd be paid for it. He was very mercenary. Ironically, he didn't pass too much information back as far as Krivitsky goes. What he did do, though, was get out and support some of that new masses effort that to kind of denigrate Krivitsky, because he would go out and tell the press that, well, Krivitsky didn't tell us anything. I'm not really sure this guy's for real. You know, he seems to be something of a fraud. So he was kind of supporting that position. So Krivitsky's starting to have issues, as I said. American immigration is starting to come down on him. He's been making a name, but he hasn't been impressing people enough with what he knows. Now, if you think about it, what does Krivitsky know? Well, he's been running several networks of Soviet agents throughout Western Europe. That alone would be a wonderful send of intelligence. He knows of connections in the United States. He knows of connections in England that could be unearthed. And this is in hindsight, by the way. The Americans didn't know this. In fact, if you think about it, late 1939, early 1940, what is the state of the American intelligence community? There's no CIA. OSS hasn't been created yet. We have the Army, so Army intelligence, we have Naval intelligence, we have the FBI. And then there's the State Department, which has always had a kind of on again, off again relationship with intelligence. You know, too often, prior to World War II, State Department intelligence consisted of, you know, cocktail party gossip. Or, even more damaging, it consisted of MI6 passing intelligence to the Americans, or MI5 passing intelligence to the Americans through the State Department, and it not getting anywhere beyond the State Department desk in Washington. So nobody acted on it. In fact, when a representative of MI5 comes over in 1940, and he starts talking to people around DC, and finds out that the FBI never hears any of the information that they'd been sending over, he writes back home and says, you know, I was up in Canada, and the RCMP used to have the same problem with the Canadian foreign establishment. But what they did was they worked out an agreement with MI5 to trade information on a security basis. In other words, domestic security, so basically communist issues. And State Department didn't care because, you know, that's not our concern. So if we don't call it foreign intelligence, we can deal directly. Maybe we should do the same thing with the FBI. Now, American intelligence has really only started to get its ducks in order for about the last 2 years. Mid-1930s. Franklin Roosevelt calls J. Edgar Hoover in and says, you know, we seem to be having more problems with groups that are connected to the Nazis and to the communists overseas. I'd like you to go and look into them some more. And Hoover says, Mr. President, you know, we don't have the authority to do that, at least directly. Now, Congress, over the years, since World War I, has been giving us the authority to do investigations for State Department. Clearly, the foreign influence on domestic groups falls under their authority, so if State Department tells us to investigate these groups, we can do it. Franklin Roosevelt calls in the Secretary of State the next morning, calls in Hoover again, and the orders are given. Now, that doesn't tell us much. It's only scratching the surface. And they're not worried about spies, and they're not worried about worried about espionage. They're worried about subversion. What kind of influence is going on? We have no clue that there are groups within the United States government beginning to get together that are going to start providing intelligence to the Soviets in a couple of years. And we're going to miss that completely because we don't even have that in our wheelhouse. We don't conceive of it at the time. But 1938, the world is approaching war. And the FBI has been increasing its espionage investigations because we've noticed espionage by Japanese agents on the West Coast. And the Navy has pointed that out to us. And on the East Coast, we know that there was at least one German spy ring already operating in New York. And we'd been involved in the investigation of that one. And so we get together with the Army and the Navy to start hashing out, if war breaks out in Europe, who's going to do what? And so it kind of comes down to the Army will take care of military Army facilities, Navy will take care of Navy facilities, and the FBI will take care of basically agents in and around the rest of the United States. By 1940, Franklin Roosevelt has us sending undercover agents to South and Central America to gather intelligence about fascist threats there. And that Special Intelligence Service, as we called it, becomes a very active gatherer of intelligence in the Western Hemisphere throughout the war. Eventually, its responsibilities get taken over by the CIA. But as far as the range and scope of what an intelligence agent does, of the threats that they can pose, of how to identify them, we know none of that. And if we'd known enough to ask Krivitsky, he probably could have helped us learn a great deal very quickly, because that's exactly what he had done for 20 years. Build up those networks, identify those agents, control them, assign them, tell them what to do, collect their intelligence, so forth. Instead, we had to learn it through the war as we experienced our own ups and downs of creating a foreign intelligence service, of tracking down German spies, of trying to run double agents for the first time, and so forth. What's going on with Krivitsky then? Well, as I said, he was having immigration problems in America, but others by this point were interested in him. His testimony before the Dies Committee, his articles, the book he wrote in Stalin's Secret Service, which was based on the articles that he wrote, all had caught the eyes of the British intelligence services. And so Krivitsky is invited up to Canada as a first stop. And the RCMP, Royal Canadian Mounted Police, take him under hand and eventually get him to Britain. And the British intelligence service is there. Valentine Vivian and Jane Archer interview him over a course of several days. Now, the Brits already knew his value. In fact, when Krivitsky had started to work with Isaac Don Levine on those articles for Saturday Evening Post, I was about to say Saturday Night Live. It's not quite the same, right? For the Saturday Evening Post, one of the things that Krivitsky had told him, but didn't make it into the article, was about a cipher clerk, code clerk, in England by the name of King, who was working for the Soviets in the Foreign Office. Actually, cipher clerk in the Foreign Office gave enough information that the Brits were able to identify him as King. And so before Krivitsky even gets over to England, they have arrested John King, got him to confess, and sent him off to jail. Now, Krivitsky doesn't know this. In fact, one of the things Krivitsky has been trying to bend over backwards to do is, this is the only gymnastics, by the way, we're going to get in this, despite what Vince suggested. But what the Brits wanted was to not let Krivitsky know that they had already used some of his intelligence to actually arrest an agent because Krivitsky did not want to betray the people he'd worked with. And he worked very hard to try and avoid that. It's one of the reasons why the U.S. never got a whole lot out of him. But at this point, Krivitsky's been having immigration problems, and he's worried that he might be kicked back to France, which would be a problem, because that would put him much closer to the Soviets. So he's more willing to open up to the Brits, not least of which he knows that they're going to keep their mouth shut. They interview him over a course of several days. He ends up coming back to Canada and back under the auspices of the RCMP, and eventually works his way back to America. This time, because of the support of the British and the Canadians and several American leaders, he is able to actually come in on a fairly sturdy immigration visa, such that he can now start to settle down. He can apply for citizenship, and he can work his way towards becoming an American. The problem is Krivitsky's becoming increasingly worried, because now it's starting to get around that he's been talking more. And so he's worried. You know, Whitaker Chambers, when he broke with Soviet intelligence, tried to go completely underground. You know, just stay out of the limelight, stay out of the public sight, and hope that through anonymity, he could escape retribution by the Soviets. Eventually, he became an editor for Time magazine, but of course, Time magazine didn't put bylines on their articles, so nobody knew what Chambers was writing. And unless you really went digging, you weren't going to find him. Krivitsky, on the other hand, is internationally known. He's written the book that came out and sold very well, did the articles. If anybody starts digging, and he knows that the Soviets have ties in Canada and England and ties to their intelligence services, he can certainly suspect that the Soviets know he's been speaking in more detail. And he starts to worry that he's being followed. And over the next months, he starts to become increasingly paranoid. On the one hand, of course, he's trying to continue making contacts that are going to help him with his writing and with settling down in America, protecting his wife and his son, Alex. On the other hand, when he runs into people who knew people or knew something about him, he's always got that thought in the back of my mind, is this going back to Soviet intelligence? And in the case of one guy, a guy named Hans Bruce, who comes over to the United States and starts bumping around in circles that Krivitsky travels in, he really starts to get scared. Bruce had been an agent of his in Europe and had been involved in wet works, among other things. So Krivitsky feared that he had been sent over to deal with him. He's having other issues as well, you know, finances, of course, being the big one. He hasn't had a steady job since he left the Soviet intelligence service. He hasn't had a steady income because he's relying on royalties from the writings that he's been doing. But of course, he's using ghostwriters and so forth to help him out because he doesn't have that kind of command of the English language. And one of them, Paul Wall, who had worked with back when he was working with Isaac Don Levine, was suing him. And so they had a real falling out. He's got money problems. He's worried that the Soviets are breathing down his back. And he's worried about the future of his family. This all comes to a head in February. On the one hand, he has begun dropping cryptic hints, telling friends of his that, you know, should I be found dead and it looks like a suicide, don't believe it. He travels to Virginia to get together with some friends of his, Eitel and Margarita Dobert, who had been known to him in Europe. It's not really clear what exactly their relationship was, but probably had intelligence connections. The Doberts had come over to America the year before and reconnected with Krivitsky. And he spent a couple days with them on a farm in the backwoods in Virginia, in Charlottesville. Krivitsky was talking about buying his own farm. And he also had gone down to Virginia for another reason, because the Doberts could help him buy a weapon, they thought, for personal protection. Bought a 38 caliber pistol. On February 9th, Margaret Dobert drives Krivitsky back to Washington. They take some time going around, apparently looking at different farms in Virginia that Krivitsky might buy to bring his family down from New York. They were living up in the Bronx at the time. She drops him off at the Bellvue Hotel that we saw earlier. And Krivitsky is given room 532. The next morning, as we saw, he was found dead. This is the side of the building, actually, the other side there. And up on the fifth floor, Krivitsky's room would have been to the left and down the side. So you can't see the window there, but the picture shows, among other things, you can picture the front of the building. The back of the building was very similar, both of which had wide expanses between the Capitol and Union Station on either side. This is the only concealed part. So if somebody was going to sneak out or sneak in, you can see there really wasn't much opportunity other than going through the halls and elevators and stairwells like a normal person. So there wasn't going to be any Mission Impossible kind of hijinks. And so we're back to the beginning, where we started. Krivitsky is found dead in his bed, 9:30, 10 o'clock in the morning. The DC police say almost immediately that it's suicide. But we can see from the timeline, the investigation itself was at best perfunctory. They think, it's probably the maid found him a bit later than 9:30. She remembered 9:30, but regardless, within an hour, an ambulance had been dismissed from the local hospital, brought a doctor with him, doctor declared him dead. Not terribly surprising, he's got two holes in one temple to the other temple. DC homicide detectives grab a couple things from the room, the gun that's at his side, a couple of notes that were found on the side table, one to his wife, one to his lawyer, and one to another friend of his. And by 1 o'clock, so not 2 hours after he's declared dead, the room's turned back over to the hotel to clean up. The bed disappears. Well, you're not gonna, just change the mattress, right? The bed disappears. DC police write up the report, bag up the gun and the other notes that were found there. The whole thing's put to bed by 3:45. Wow. This is not even CSI. This is much faster. Part of the paperwork that was found, of course, mentioned Lewis Waldman. And the DC police call him and tell him that we've found the body of this guy. He signed in as Walter Pareff, but some of the other identification here, a passport, suggests his name is Ginsburg. And as I said, Waldman immediately said it was not a suicide, it was a murder. But he doesn't tell the DC police who the guy actually was. Instead, he goes to the press first, and then, of course, heads down to DC. So Waldman starts pressing the government. He takes a look at some of the notes that are left. This is obviously a very bad copy of the Russian translation of the note that Krivitsky left to his wife and son. His son at the time was about 8 years old. It says, in part, "It is difficult for me to write, but think about me and then you will understand that I must go. Don't tell Alec yet where his father is gone. I believe that in time you will tell him, because it will be well, I'm trying to throw another word in here, but it's not actually there, because it will best for him. Forgive, it is very hard to write. Take care of him and be a good mother to him, and always be always quiet and never get angry at him. He is very good and always very pale. Good people will help you, but not enemies. I think my sins are big. I see you, Tonya and Alec. I embrace you. Yours." Well, the letters, of course, show some sign of duress. Questions, of course, immediately rise about what's going on. Waldman tries to bring the FBI in on it. And the FBI throws up its hands and says, no, this is a local murder case. This is not our responsibility. Hoover wrote, this is Hoover's writing, "We are not in this case. We are not going to be baited into it by newspaper promotion tactics." And that remains the FBI's story through this. Waldman, though, argued that Krivitsky had everything going for him at the time. He wasn't going to commit suicide. Now, looking back at Krivitsky's actions over the last couple of months, I think he certainly was showing some signs of depression. I think Waldman's trying to make the best case of this. And I think, you know, he's at least sincere in thinking that this is a murder. But Waldman himself isn't able to make that case. The DC police take a closer look at some of what they got. Obviously, they've missed some great opportunities forensically already, but end up concluding again that this was suicide. So the question remains, what did happen? Well, if we think about it, what have we learned over the last number of years? There have been, over time, a number of things coming out of Moscow. In the 1980s, one defector said, "I got a chance to look through Krivitsky's KGB file." And like the files of Ignaz Reis and some others, it was marked with an L for liquid. My Russian is no good, and I apologize for this. Liquidatsia, or liquidation, suggesting, of course, that he was killed like Reis was. On the other hand, another defector later on, who wrote a book, Pseudoplatov, says no. In fact, the center was very surprised at Krivitsky's death. So what do we have? Well, the latest word comes down to this. About 10 years ago, noted historians John Haynes and Harvey Clare, working with a former reporter and trained KGB agent named Alexander Vasiliev, made publicly available a number of notebooks that Vasiliev had compiled in the course of research on a book with Alan Weinstein, who was our former national archivist and wrote a very definitive work on the Alger Hiss case. Vasiliev was given access, because of his earlier KGB connections, to the actual files. And he was allowed to take notes from them, verbatim. But then what he had to do was take them home, summarize them, and then a committee of KGB would, well, wasn't called the KGB at that point, but the KGB's successors would vet the notes. And largely they took out names of sources and that sort of thing, kind of like what we do with FOIA today, Freedom of Information Act. And in one of those files, detailing the NKVD intelligence operation in America in the mid-40s, just before the end of World War II, there was this line. Cultivation of Enemy. Enemy was the cover name used for Krivitsky. The defector Krivitsky. Cultivation is over. Enemy took his own life. Cultivation is an odd term, and I haven't had a chance to find out what the Russian actually was. If you want, it's here, but you know, obviously it's not that easy to read. And I don't read Russian. If it was Greek, I might try and parse it out for you, but even then I'm not that good. But as far as it goes, I think cultivation refers to basically paying very close attention for future action. In other words, they would follow Krivitsky. They would keep track of his movements. In fact, the fact that they were tasking Crook or Samuel Dickstein to keep an eye on him suggests that. Venona also suggests it because there were contacts that Krivitsky knew. David Dahlin, who wrote a book on Soviet espionage, he was socialist in the day who took a very anti-Stalinist take. But a lot of the people who had fallings out with Stalinism kind of congregated around Dahlin and his wife, Lydia Estrin, in those days. They kept eyes on them. A guy named Mark Zbierowski, you heard of him last week because he was involved in keeping an eye on Trotsky. Well, after Trotsky, he came to New York and was paying attention up here as well. And eventually, goes back to Europe and does some other things. But the KGB was keeping an eye on Krivitsky. So I think Sudoplatov's statement about them being surprised when he killed himself rings true. Question could still be open. It's certainly possible the Soviets have done it before, as you've learned over the last couple of weeks. But in this case, I think we're left with a murder and not with, with a suicide and not with a murder. How's that? I go and blow the whole thing I've been arguing all over. Must be getting tired. But on that note, what I'd like to do is open it up for questions. Happy to try and answer anything on this, or if you have broader questions about intelligence history and some of the things I mentioned, I'd be happy to tackle those. And I'll probably punt if it's a more current eventsy sort of thing. Yes, sir. And please do wait for the microphone.
Wouldn't this have been fairly easy to solve forensically? For example, someone committing suicide would have his hand on the weapon, whereas if someone is murdered, their fingerprints would certainly not be on the weapon with which they were murdered. So,
good question. One, the way the human body reacts after you've taken a bullet to the head, between muscle spasms and everything else, doesn't mean you're necessarily going to be holding the gun afterward. Possible, but not necessarily. So given that, though, forensically, yes, this should have been open and shut if they had taken the time to actually do a murder investigation. Is there gunshot residue on the guy's hands? I assume they were looking for gunshot residue back then. It's not that big a concept. But they didn't. Physically, we don't know the exact details of how the body was found. Was it moved and some of that stuff? And it's not clear. I haven't seen the coroner's report, and I don't know how detailed it is. If I ever go into this any more deeply, that's the first thing I'm going to want to do. What are the details? I mean, the general gist of it is found lying on the bed. It could mean all sorts of things. On the other hand, the door was locked. As I said, he was in the fifth floor, so it wasn't easy egress from an outside window. On the other hand, finding a skeleton key and getting the lock open, not that big a deal. But here's a guy who's incredibly suspicious. He just bought a revolver to defend himself. So there certainly should have been a struggle. If someone had broken into his room in the middle of the night, he was thought to have been killed somewhere between probably 1:30 and 3:30. So Soviet intelligence was always good and always years ahead of us. It wasn't superhuman. So I think we're left then again with suicide. Yes, sir.
I'm wondering what you touched on a little bit his financial situation. I'm obviously suicide, life insurance doesn't pay off on suicide, but even if he had it. But
and there's no evidence that there was a life insurance policy.
Was there?
No. Oh. Not that I know of.
Well, I guess what happened to his wife and child, and what was their financial situation? Because that would, you know, sort of give an indication of if he's so concerned about them, it seemed like he'd be worried.
His death didn't put them in any worse of a situation, in the sense that they were kind of living on the kindness of friends already. It's not clear what happened to her afterwards. By the late mid to late 1940s, when the FBI actually has an idea of what's been going on with Soviet intelligence, they decide to try and find her again, and it takes them a while. She's kind of gone under the radar, and eventually they do track her down, at least from the release of material on Krivitsky himself. There's no indication that they got any detailed information or anything from her, or that they kept track of her after that. It looks like she just disappeared into the woodwork. For all I know, her son may still be alive. Alec would have been, you know, 8 in 1941, so it's possible. Be pretty old at this point, obviously. I doubt she's alive. But we don't know what happened. In fact, that's one of the interesting mysteries. There's a good book on the case by a guy named Gary Kern called Death in Washington. Well-researched. He was able to at least interview the Doberrs before they died. But there's no evidence that he ever found Mrs. Krivitsky, or Alec, for that matter. Yes, ma'am.
First of all, I'd like to compliment you. Your pronunciation of liquidatse is very good. I tend to agree with you, if nothing else, because when Stalin did kill his enemies, and we know he killed quite a few, he always tried to make it very known to everyone that he did it. Because obviously, so that will be a lesson.
Yeah, the bragging rights kind of went along with it, right. And of course fed into the future fear for potential apostates, I guess would be the way to put it, yes.
Right, so based on that, I think that probably was a suicide.
Yeah, no, I think you're right. I think that, you know, those kinds of assassinations are meant to be a public statement. Even if, you know, one, it looks like a suicide, or two, you know, someone's found riddled with machine gun bullets on the side of a French road. Everybody knows who the person was, and they didn't just wander into, you know, random machine gun fire. It was, or for that matter, an ice pick. The whole kind of plot to get up to that point of killing the person is meant to be very secret and can be very convoluted. What happens afterward is left to public. Yes. You're next.
Maybe I missed this, but was the gun that killed him the same one that he had purchased?
Yes. Or
it was?
As far as they can, there was some argument over whether or not it was a 38 or a 32 that killed him. As far as we can tell, the best evidence is that it was the gun that he used to kill himself. Now, I should have mentioned this. Kern suggests three possibilities. One is he killed himself. Two is he was basically forced into or blackmailed into killing himself. In other words, you know, the Soviet intelligence made threats against his wife and kids, said, if you don't kill yourself, we're going to kill you. Or three is the harder to believe scenario where someone actually sets it up and makes it look like a false suicide. There's no way we can know whether or not they forced him into it. I think in part some of the documentary record over the years that, you know, at least is kind of leaked out of the Soviet Union, it's not conclusive, but it's suggestive that they didn't blackmail him into it. But it's certainly a viable possibility. I still come down on the side. He had been getting increasingly paranoid, and I think he really, you know, kind of saw it as, I should get out of this before, you know, in a sense, he kind of blackmailed himself, I think, you know, at least as far as I'm reading his personality and, you know, his actions in the last couple of weeks. wait for that.
Well, I was just going to say, in terms of cultivating him, if you're being followed by the Soviets, that would be pretty intimidating.
Well, the problem is, he was and he wasn't. You know, he didn't know about Dick Stein. No one did at the time, other than the Soviets. It's not clear whether Hans Bruce was actually, you know, officially looking for him or not. I think Krivitsky was kind of occupationally paranoid, and understandably so. You know, he'd just come off of a couple of years where he saw all of his friends and idols killed, and, you know, had obviously, you know, kind of, he'd gotten himself lost in that wilderness of mirrors. Sir.
Was the purpose in writing the articles in the book just simply simply financial, because it would seem to be the last thing you'd want to do if you were trying to keep a low profile as write for the highest circulation magazine in the country?
When you are trying to get out of a occupation like Krivitsky had, you can go two ways. You can try and go as anonymous as you can and basically say, hey, look, I'm just keeping my mouth shut. I'm not doing anything. Some people kind of say Alexander Orlov went that way, who was another, you know, defector who Krivitsky knew right around the same time. He basically largely kept his mouth shut, although he did kind of sort of talk with the FBI over the years, but never to the detail that he could have. Krivitsky, well, or take Whitaker Chambers. You know, Whitaker Chambers went the, I'm going to keep myself under the radar as best as possible. Until the whole, you know, thing with, you know, he got outed by Elizabeth Bentley and got into the whole argument with Alger Hiss. Krivitsky went the other way. I'm going to, one, denounce the Stalinists, and two, I'm going to try and make myself publicly known enough that maybe they won't go after me. But you can tell from his actions and from his statements that that whole, you know, hey, no, I'm much too visible. You know, when he starts looking for you know, a possible place in the countryside, you know, trying upstate New York, you know, Virginia, you know, we're talking back, you know, dirt roads and, you know, off the beaten path. So, yeah, he was a mixed bag on that. I don't think his witness, kind of to use Whitaker Chambers' word there, was, I think it was a little more motivated by money than it was by the other, but he wanted to get back at Stalin too for killing his friends and heroes.
Whatever happened to Hans Bruce?
I don't know. You know, Bruce is a name that I'd have to go looking more and see what the FBI turned up on him. But you know, as far as this went, I didn't have the time to go through FOIA to get it available, so I didn't bother. Sorry. Oh, come back to this side in a minute. Sorry.
At the start, you said that, excuse me, that you said there were three suicide notes. Who were the other two?
Well, one was to the lawyer, Waldman. One was to his wife and son. And the third was to a woman named Susan La Follette, who was the sister or daughter of Robert La Follette, the progressive Republican from the Midwest. Follette. Yes, thank you. So she had been an acquaintance of his for a number of years. Yes, we had a couple over here.
Hi. Since he published things in the press, and you said wrote a book about, you know, Stalin, presumably a translation or a summary or something was made into Russian and at some level provided to Stalin. Is there?
No reports of it that I know of.
No evidence that Stalin actually read it and commented
on it? Well, I don't think Stalin liked to read much. I'm not sure he would have read it anyway, but, you know, at least as far, you know, Stalin took his intelligence reports verbally, if I remember. I might be wrong on that, but that certainly would have happened if he had been writing about J. Edgar Hoover. Hoover cared deeply about what others were writing about him. I'm not sure Stalin did so much.
Well,
I don't want to do them both at the same time, but I can if you want.
Okay, well,
yes, ma'am.
Following up, how did it come to light that the New York congressman was being paid by the communists?
We did not learn about that here in the United States until Alexander, between, darn it, Weinstein. What's his first name? Alan Weinstein, thank you, and Alexander Vasiliev. Getting tongue-tied here now. Until they came out with the book, The Haunted Wood, which was based on Vasiliev's notes from the KGB files. And he was the one who had found the information about Dick Stein. And then more detail about it came out when Vasiliev worked with Haynes and Clare to make available his original notebooks, which he had smuggled out of Russia after he moved to England. And he's, I think he's still there. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
It seems to me that the couple that lived in Charlottesville and helped him buy the gun and also dropped him off at the place where he was killed the next day should have been able to, somebody should have gotten some information from them. What did they learn?
They did. In fact, by the next, I'll go back. Marguerite drops him off at 5:30, 5 o'clock-ish. She goes to another hotel to stay for the night, visits with some friends the next morning. And when she finds out in the afternoon that there's this public announcement about this guy killing himself, she realizes that it was Krivitsky and immediately goes back home. Kind of making up, a story here and there about how she's been called back, has to get to her husband because he has to do a talk somewhere. The Dope Bears had been Germans. And Dober had ended up working in some way, apparently, with Krivitsky. He was an anti-fascist. And there were a lot of questions, could they have been involved in some kind of plot? And the fact that, their initial response, there were all sorts of responses in the press. The problem is, who knows which parts were right and which parts were wrong? Was it the Doberes making mistakes in what they were reporting? Was the press, kind of adding or, ad-libbing some of this as it went along? And it happens. So the testimony in that regard is kind of muddled. But, the reconstruction over it over the years, and the Doberes were interviewed by several people over time, all seems to come down fairly strongly on the, basically, they were just scared and didn't want to get wrapped up in the whole thing and overwhelmed by the media in the aftermath of Krivitsky's death. Krivitsky's note that I had read from earlier, of course, at the bottom says, I'm writing this from the Doberes farm. They, what was his word? I did not have any strength in New York. I did not have any business in Washington. I went to see the Doberes because that's the only place I could get the firearm. So he's kind of trying to push suspicion away from them. Certainly Marguerite couldn't have, how should I put it, faked the murder to look like a suicide. And, if the Soviets had been following Krivitsky, they could have picked him up in a number of places. So by all appearances, they were not involved. They were what they said they were.
I just want to make sure. Did I hear you say that there were two shots in?
One shot.
Oh, one shot. Okay.
That's okay. two holes, left, right temple. Now, of course, none of the reports suggest, which side was shot from. I haven't seen anything that said whether he was right-handed or left-handed. Which at least would, give you a question as to how he held the gun and so forth. So, forensically, there's a lot more information I think we'd want to know. As far as the pieces go together, both from then and now, I think the weight of the evidence is he killed himself.
Just a quick comment, if I may.
Sure.
Stalin was a ferocious reader. He read and spoke almost fluently in five different languages, including English. A book that I would highly recommend is something called Young Stalin that writes about, you know, he was a thug, and he was a tyrant, and he murdered millions of his own people. But when it comes to reading, he did like to read.
Okay, thank you. I was afraid I was wrong on that one.
Thank you, John.
One last question.
So I just wondered, so when the CIA came about and evolved, which I always thought that was from the OSS, was a good contingent of those FBI folks that were, you know, the intelligence,
anecdotal.
Did they go over to the CIA?
Actually, a number of them did, yes. And there's some argument that could be made that even the model of how they set up, you know, their overseas operations resembles the FBI's model a lot more than the OSS model. What the OSS really brought to the party was their analytic division, and the FBI didn't have anything like that. So it was that combination of analytic and operational activity that the OSS had, whereas I think the FBI in some ways brought more influence on the gathering of the intelligence itself. In that regard, especially in South and Central America, which is where we were stationed. We didn't have undercover agents operating in the rest of the world. Thank you very much. Good.